Funding for Election 2016 coverage is made possible by AARP, a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization dedicated to helping people turn their goals and dreams into real possibilities and changing the way America defines aging. And by the members of Prairie Public.
Welcome to Prairie Public and AARP's coverage of Election 2016. I'm Matt Olien. This is the debate for North Dakota's congressional seat in the U.S. House of Representatives. My guests today are Libertarian Jack Seaman, Republican Congressman Kevin Cramer, and Democrat Chase Iron Eyes. Each candidate will have a 1 minute opening and closing statements with debate in between. Let's start with opening statements first. Jack Seaman.
Well, hello again, Matt. Good to be with you again. And thanks again for having us in. It's always an honor to be here. And thanks to those folks tuning in or listening. We appreciate your part of the process. And again, you have a big decision in front of you, and we're just glad that you're here to join us and listen to what we have to say. America's at a crossroads, there's no doubt about that. There's more than 60% of the nation that doesn't even identify as Democrat or Republican anymore. Those are the independent voices, those are the libertarian voices of our country. And if there ever was a time for a third party to emerge in politics here in North Dakota and across the country, I think this year is the time that we're seeing it. It's the rise of the anti-establishment candidate. And that's what I presented to you voters in 2014, and that's what I present to you here in 2016. If you're looking for someone that wants a small constitutional federal government with more power to the people and to the states, then I'm your guy.
Okay, Kevin Cramer, 1 minute opening statement.
Thanks, Matt, for inviting us again, for hosting this, and thanks to Prairie Public Television and to AARP, as well as to Jack and to Chase. This is, as Jack said, this is an important decision you make every couple of years. I love the People's House for that reason. The fact that we're up every 2 years, that the power is in the hands of the people as opposed to the politicians, and debates like this give you, the people, the opportunity to size up your incumbent as well as those that would challenge for the position that's so important. North Dakota only gets one member of the House of Representatives. You've honored me by letting me be your representative these last two terms, as now I seek a third term. And while there have been many frustrations, there have also been some tremendous successes. Things like the passage of a long-term highway bill, fully funded. First time we've had a five-year highway bill since the 1990s. Funding and authorization of a Water Resources Development Act, a repeal of the No Child Left Behind education program, and elimination of all of the incentives for the federal government to coerce states into accepting Common
Core. Okay, that's 1 minute. Time's up. You can get to all that later,
all right, thank
Congressman.
You.
Thank you. Chase Iron Eyes, 1 minute opening statement.
Thank you, and I want to thank the sponsors as well. I want to say that North Dakota and our country is at a great critical time in our history. We have existential world crises that are facing us as North Dakotans, and we can't ignore the importance of our role in geopolitics, a worldwide global politics. We have natural resources, we have the talent, and we have to be dutiful. We have to be mindful that our economy reflects our values. Our energy development is responsible. As North Dakotans, we can't forget our roots. We can't forget where we came from and what built us, and that was farming, ranching, and hard work, and a respect for the waters and the lands that give us an economy that are the source of all economic wealth. We face great challenges, but North Dakotans are built for great challenges.
Yep.
Thank you.
That 1 minute. Let's start with our first issue, and Jack Seaman's going to lead us off on this one. Let's start with the hot button issue in the state right now, the Dakota Access Pipeline. I want to hear all of your opinions on this project, how it was handled and permitted, and the ensuing protests, and where it goes from here. Jack Seaman, you start off.
Well, first of all, I just think it's unfortunate that we find ourselves in the position that we're in now in this project, and it's a shame that it's gotten this far. Quite honestly, when the protests first started happening, I was kind of more understanding to the plight of the tribe, because I was questioning whether or not they had meaningful consultation on the project to begin with. And now that I've done a little more homework and I've seen a little more information, it's becoming quite clear to me that both Energy Transfer Partners and the Army Corps of Engineers went above and beyond. They did an enormous amount of work to make sure that the tribe was asked to be part of the process. They respected the culture, they respected the land, they respected everything throughout the process. And now we seem to be stuck in a position to where they can't move forward because of changing rules set in place by the Obama administration. So I'm not exactly sure where we would go from here. As a citizen, I would call on my representatives in Washington, like Congressman Cramer, to dial up the White House and see who can get on the line, and let's see if we can get this thing resolved. And here, as a citizen of North Dakota, I would like to see our governor, Jack Dalrymple, involved, and let's get the solution to a resolution quickly.
Chase Ironeyes, response?
Yes, well, I can't ignore the issue because I live south of where the pipeline was slated to go. And for me, it's a matter of respect. I think it's calling into question the social evolution that our country, our great country, was founded upon. And that is a base level of respect for each other as human beings. And I don't know if that's being played out in what's happening in the Dakota Access Pipeline. I went to the North Dakota Petroleum Council specifically to meet with Energy Transfer Partners. I wasn't able to do that. I met with Continental Resources guy. But for the position that we need to be talking to each other, we can't operate in vacuums. And that's what's going on with our governor declaring a state of emergency, activating the National Guard, and supporting a roadblock. It's crazy times, but they're most important times. And we have the strength within us to respect each other and find a solution, because North Dakota we're in the top 9 in the world in terms of oil plays, worldwide oil plays. The same forces and conglomerates that are in Iran, Saudi Arabia, Venezuela are right here in North Dakota. And we need to develop our resources on North Dakota's terms, not on outside companies' terms.
Okay, Kevin Cramer, response.
I think Chase makes an important point. This should be on North Dakota's terms, and that's what this pipeline was cited on, North Dakota's terms. It was cited by the Public Service Commission with thorough, not just adequate, but more than thorough hearings and consultation. One of the challenges we have today, Matt, is that some people confuse consultation with consent. Well, if you're going to have consent on everything, you wouldn't need arbiters, you wouldn't need courts, you wouldn't need administrative agencies, you wouldn't need legislators for that matter. So 9 times the Energy Transfer Partners met with the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe. They had 389 meetings with 55 different tribes. Consultation took place. That doesn't mean that the result was to everybody's liking. But I think we have to also understand that pipelines, there are thousands of pipelines, millions of miles of pipelines under the United States soil. This will be the latest, greatest, 100 feet below the floor of the Missouri River. If it ran just north of my home, it would be fine with me. I think it's the safest pipeline possible. The biggest concern I have, though, is that we have an administration who, after the rules were drafted, after the rules were followed, they then changed the rules and tried to retroactively apply prospective thinking. If we need to, you know, have a different consultation process, I think that's a discussion worth having. But you have to make it prospective and not retroactive, lest you scare all investment away in all job creation in this country.
Okay, Jack Seaman, response?
Well, one thing that we haven't talked about yet, Matt, is the safety of moving oil via pipeline. It's the safest possible way to move the oil. And unless people want to stop consuming oil, stop driving automobiles, or stop heating your homes with it, we're going to consume oil. That oil is produced here in North Dakota, and it's good for our state to get that oil to market. There's no question the pipeline is by far and away the safest way possible to get that oil to market. This pipeline has been well studied, well documented, and will be a safe pipeline. And if you want to talk about the safety of North Dakotans overall, if we're all in this together, then the pipeline is the safest way to get that oil to market.
Okay, Chase Ironeyes, and specifically for you, Chase, did the folks down there know about this ahead of time? Did you know about it ahead of time? Take me through that, I guess, and you can respond however you want. But specifically, you live there, so.
Yes. So I moved back to the reservation in 2014. And I remember Energy Transfer Partners coming to the Tribal Council, and they were told that, you know, we don't consent to this pipeline. Free, prior, and informed consent is a term of art in international law. And so I just think we need to be respecting each other, and I did I did go to the North Dakota Petroleum Council. I went right to people who build pipelines to find out about how safe pipelines are and whether or not loss of water, fresh water resources was used to determine whether, you know, when they claim that pipelines are the safest way to transport oil. I just don't feel that we should be putting our water resource at risk. I realize that pipelines need to move our oil to other markets. But I think Energy Transfer, they lied to the people saying that this was American oil to be consumed on American soil. They've since backed off of that. And we have candidates like Kevin Cramer who are funded by the Koch brothers and Big Energy. We have a governor, we have Senator Hovind, we have people who, if I'm a lawyer, if I accepted that amount of campaign contributions and I was expected to regulate that very industry, that is a textbook conflict of interest. I would lose my law license for self-dealing instead of getting reelected.
Okay, Kevin Cramer, final response, and then we'll
sure.
move to another topic.
Well, Chase is confusing representative government with being a lawyer. We're running for a job where we represent the people that elect us, and that is the people of North Dakota, the workers on the pipelines. That's why the unions are so strongly opposed to President Obama and trying to encourage him to get this thing to a settlement so we can build this pipeline. So he's confusing politics with good policy. But with regard to the consultation process, I think this is important. I think it is important we have a discussion about whether there should be a different consultation process. But we can't apply a new process to a previous investment. Again, there are lots of things, not just oil pipelines, gas pipelines, transmission lines, clean energy projects, wind farms, highways, bridges, buildings, all kinds of development that is right now really in flux, Matt, because people who invest billions of dollars in this infrastructure are at a standstill because we don't know what the rules are going to be going forward, nor whether the rules will even continue to be upheld if they are established.
Okay, let's move to national security. Chase Ironeyes, you're going to start us off on this one. Significant issue now in the wake of the San Bernardino and Orlando attacks. As a congressman in Washington, what would each of you advocate in terms of overseas battles against ISIS and also detecting homegrown terrorism? Chase, you start us off.
Thank you for that question. I think we need to be ever vigilant in defeating terrorism. Terrorism is cowardly. Terrorism is a threat, but we also have to be mindful about our foreign policies and what might cause people to take those measures against us. I come from a military family. I was raised by veterans. I have known nothing but war since my older brother went over to Operation Desert Storm in the early 90s. My cousins have gone over there multiple times. My good friends from high school have served with honor. They have Purple Hearts, they have Bronze Stars, and I understand fully. But I think what we need to be doing to protect, if we're going to say that we're truly interested in protecting our national security, then we need to be truthful with ourselves about protecting our water resources, because there is no economic wealth unless it flows from a clean, fresh water source. That includes the Bakken play, that includes our lignite resources, that includes hunting, fishing, all farming, all ranching, all agriculture. Even our tourism industry is dependent upon water and protecting our natural resources as a form of national security. Around the globe, we are facing existential crises. We're facing water shortages. We're facing global warming. I'm not a climate denier like Kevin Cramer. I am one who is going to prepare for climate change because it's real. Science is saying it's real. And I just think we need to elect leadership that have a global view such as that.
Okay, Kevin Cramer, response.
Well, along the lines of global existentialism, I believe that America's national security and America's economic security are tied directly to America's energy security. And while water is important, and thank God North Dakota has a lot of it, and it's clean, some of the cleanest water in the world because of our good stewardship that comes from our agrarian roots, we also are blessed with other natural resources like lignite coal, like natural gas, like oil. And those natural resources allow us to be energy secure. So we're not dependent on the Middle East. We don't have to spend billions of dollars protecting the straits that are the lines of for vessels that carry foreign crude oil. So that's an important part of our national security. to be sure. But you don't have to have one without the other. And while I am a climate skeptic, not a denier, I do believe that the climate changes. I think it has for millions of years. I'm not also not a climate worshiper. And people that take this political agenda and apply it, try to apply it broadly, are denying certain realities, Matt. Things like that somehow the United States is solely responsible for climate change, that we're solely responsible for fixing it, that somehow if the United States didn't exist, there wouldn't be global warming. And they want to unilaterally disarm our economy and call that somehow geopolitically responsible. I deny that.
Okay, Jack Seaman, response.
Well, my position on this, surprise, surprise, has not changed in the last 2 years. And I know that Kevin and I were at polar opposites on this issue in 2014, and I remain steadfast in the libertarian philosophy of non-interventionism. If you want to protect America from terrorists like ISIS or any other threat around the world, the best way to do that is to get out of their backyard and stop spending trillions of dollars and tens of thousands of lives trying to fight a battle against religion and a battle against ideology. We've been doing it for about 15 years now, and had it been successful, we'd see a lot less terrorism risks. We'd all feel a lot safer in our homes and in our communities, and we wouldn't have such a drastic national debt problem. But that's not the case. We've been fighting it. We've been funding money into it. And I honestly think if you would ask any of us, ask ourselves, do we feel safer now than we did in 2001? The answer would be no. So what we're really talking about here is a failed policy that's crippling the nation economically. And it's a big driver of our $20 trillion national debt. And if you want to talk about threats to the American people and threats to our way of life, the $20 trillion national debt is one of the biggest ones of all.
I need to move to the next topic. You can address this again in your closing statements if you want. Kevin Cramer, you're going to lead us off on this one. Economy, specifically North Dakota's, which now appears to have been very dependent on energy, as falling oil prices have caused across-the-board budget cuts. So my question is North Dakota too dependent on energy, and what could be done to fortify the state's economy from your seat in Washington?
So Washington doesn't fortify economies. Washington just screws them up for the most part. So I would say that a flatter, simpler tax code that we've advocated in the House Republican Conference and we've in fact passed would help. Elimination, and one of the things I'm most pleased by that we were able to do in this last session was to make 179 expensing permanent law at $500,000. Now that sounds sort of wonkish, but what that means is that a farmer now can buy a piece of equipment and he can deduct it all in the year that he purchased it. And those kinds of opportunities to get out of the way are better for diversifying an economy. Now, with regard to North Dakota specifically being dependent on energy, we just saw the most recent numbers that came out, I think, in the last day or two, showing that our economy is getting back to the previous normal. The problem isn't the previous normal. The problem is perhaps become the new normal. And that's a matter of state revenue and budgeting. But with regard to our economy, I think it can be quite stable. But we do have to have good common sense policies that again, roll back regulation, let farmers, let manufacturers, let energy industries do the things that they do the best without the overbearing hand of the government, both in taxation and regulation. That's the best thing Congress can do.
Okay, Jack Seaman, response.
Well, I do have to admit, I liked a couple things Kevin talked about there with eliminating some regulation and taxation. But when you talk about farmers and you talk about industry here in North Dakota and oil and commodity prices are down, and that's hurting everyone's pocketbooks, it has for quite a while. One of the biggest drivers of those prices is Federal Reserve policy. And I don't want to make all your viewers' eyes glaze over here, Matt, but we got to talk about it because the Federal Reserve isn't any more federal than Federal Express. It's a private banking cartel that we have given control over our money supply and control over our interest rate policy. And when they can manipulate markets through one simple meeting that are huge drivers to our interest rates, the purchasing power of a dollar, and how far that dollar goes for our farmers and our ranchers and our citizens here in North Dakota, that's what's really crippling our economy here in North Dakota. The best thing I could do if elected would be to go to Washington, audit, and finally end the Federal Reserve.
Okay, Chase Iron Eyes, response.
I think that taxation, I would like to see the millionaires and the billionaires and the Koch brothers that fund Kevin Cramer be taxed at the same rate that North Dakota working families are taxed at. Having said that, I would invest in a 21st century North Dakota. We have leadership. We have talent. We need to invest in our critical thinking education from Head Start all the way to NDSU and UND. We need to invest in our students, make sure that they're not saddled with the price of a mortgage coming out of college like I was. We need to make sure that our women are paid the same as men for doing the exact same job. We're trying to create a 21st century North Dakota, a 21st century America. And we have to recognize patriarchy. We have to recognize that guys like Kevin Cramer and Donald Trump, who say they would punish women for making health care decisions on their own, doesn't have a place in the 21st century. I really think that we need to take care of our seniors. We should not privatize Social Security. I think we need to take care of our veterans. They shouldn't have to drive all the way to Fargo to get the health care that they need. And we just have to be clicking on all levels. We have, if we want to talk about an all-of-the-above energy approach, then we have to be cognizant that everything is commodity-driven right now in North Dakota.
Our last question comes from our co-sponsor, AARP of North Dakota. If elected, what action would you take to update Social Security, which Mr. Iron Eyes just mentioned, so it's financially sound and provides adequate income for current and future generations? Jack Seaman, you go first.
Sure, that's a great question, and it's one that we need to pay attention to. We need to start giving this serious attention immediately. If we don't take this very seriously and take immediate action on this, this program is headed for a financial disaster. The numbers show that this program is not being funded enough through the payroll taxes, and it's running at a deficit currently. That deficit is only going to continue to get greater and greater, and it looks like we could be insolvent as early as 2034. So I think that we need to completely change Social Security in its entirety. I think we need to take care of the people that are at or near the retirement age and make sure they get the benefits that they are certainly entitled to, that they paid for their whole lives. But if we want to fix this program, the only way we can fix it is to allow our young people to opt out. So in a generation or two from now, there will be no more Social Security. There will be no more burden to the American taxpayer, and people will fund their own retirement accounts on their own individually the way it should be.
Okay, Chase Iron Eyes, response.
Thank you. 22% of North Dakota's elders. I come from a culture that respects our elders. 22% of our elders are solely dependent on Social Security. That's almost at the poverty level. They are struggling. I've met with local Fargo elders who are highly organized, and I assured them that I will not privatize Social Security. When we're talking about our most vulnerable people, they need to have at least the basis of income to take care of themselves. This is the American dream. They invested their entire lifetimes, their blood, sweat, and tears, and the time that they could have been spending with their children for working for their pensions, for their retirement plans, for their 401ks. I don't know if any of you guys personally lost money from Wall Streeters and big banks gambling with our 401ks, but I lost a lot of money in 2008. And I won't let that same thing happen to our elders. I can tell you that. I can guarantee you that.
Okay, last response, Kevin Cramer.
Using 401ks with Social Security, completely different things altogether. In the previous question, he beat up on people like the Koch brothers who contribute to our economy and then gave a long list of new expenses that would somehow grow our economy by taking care of people from the cradle to the grave with no sense of how you would ever pay for that, and it certainly wouldn't help the economy. With regard to Social Security, we can make small tweaks today that would have tremendous benefits in the long run. And I think that's what we need to do. The problem is the Democratic Party never wants to talk about Social Security or Medicare except to scare people by suggesting that somehow Republicans are out to end it. And so they aren't willing to come to the table. Matt, we've passed legislation that has very small tweaks to Social Security because you can apply changes to people well into the future that won't apply to people that are at or near the retirement age today, that would have tremendous benefits in the long run. Today, we aren't paying enough in for the money that's going out. But the biggest problem is, getting back to a point Jack made earlier, it's the biggest driver of our budget. 66% of our federal budget is off limits because of Social Security and Medicare.
Need to get to closing statements. I know this goes fast. Chase Iron Eyes, you go first on closing.
Thank you. I think what we're witnessing right now is a movement, is an organic energy to put people over politics and to hold those accountable who sell out to big money, who sell out to big energy, who don't look out for North Dakota's true best interest. I'm beholden to nobody except the people of North Dakota, the land, the waters, and the healthy ecosystems that sustain our economy in North Dakota. I will not accept a dime from dark money Koch brothers like Kevin Cramer has done his whole career. That's just innately incomprehensible to me. It causes a cognitive dissonance. It fundamentally disagrees with my spiritual dignity. I need to be able to make decisions on behalf of all North Dakotans and create a 21st century North Dakota.
Thank you. Kevin Cramer, 1 minute close.
When a politician tells you that he complains about his opponent's support from the constituency he serves, what he's saying is that since no one will support me, I'm beholden to nobody. But politics is a business of the people's business. The House of Representatives is. With regard to contributions, we have the most transparent contribution system in the world in the United States of America. So yes, I take contributions, by the way, all legal, and all of them limited at $2,700 per contribution from lots of North Dakota entities and industries. And it's a pleasure to serve the people of North Dakota. It's a blessing. The fact that I have the most town halls of any member of Congress is not a testament to me as much as it is to the people of North Dakota, because I rely on the people of North Dakota for their advice, for their ideas, for their suggestions, and for their questions. And I thank you for the opportunity and hope I can earn your support for a third term in the United States House of Representatives. Thanks, Matt, and to Pray Public for this debate.
And Jack Seaman, closing statement.
Well, thank you, Matt, and thanks to Chase and Kevin for being here. We've had a lively debate. Too bad it couldn't have been an hour. I think what you're presented with, once again, is a choice between two candidates from the old establishment parties. We know what we're going to get with a Democrat. We know what we're going to get with Kevin Cramer. And if you want to send someone to Washington that will consistently and principally vote no quite often on fiscal matters and vote yes quite often on social matters, then I'm your guy. Our government's way too big, it spends too much, and it tries to do too much. Kevin here has supported many spending bills that send our nation further and further into debt. So he can't claim to be a fiscal conservative. And we know that Chase is a proponent of bigger and bigger government, and I don't think that's good for our nation either. So I'm asking for your vote on November 8th, because the libertarian way of maximum personal freedom and limited federal government is exactly what the people of North Dakota need right now. Thank you.
Thanks to all of you. Our time is up, and thank you for watching Prairie Public and AARP's coverage of Election 2016. So long.
Funding for Election 2016 coverage is made possible by AARP, a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization dedicated to helping people turn their goals and dreams into real possibilities and changing the way America defines aging. And by the members of Prairie Public.